I wanted to do a special episode and show you what I can of Hitler's actual bunkers. The Fuhrer bunkers that we knew he had, what they looked like, and what footage we have of them, including their layout and designs. Because in so many locations, we have been told that General Hans Kammler was building a Fuhrer Hauptquartier. The entire concept behind Project Reise was that he was building a scattered Fuhrer Hauptquartier with all the different bunkers for all the different departments of government. The same we've been told out at the S3 in Jonastal. He was building a Fuhrer Hauptquartier. Yet, after much going over what Kammler actually was doing with the help of his engineer Fiebinger, Kammler was not at any point involved in building any such shelters for anyone. In fact, if we look at all the different projects General Kammler oversaw, including the 20 I've been sent pictures and diagrams over by the FBI, it is very clear to see that at no point in time did he not work on projects that directly involved the war effort or the construction of secure facilities for which factories, production, and research could move underground. And if you look at the entities within the Third Reich that actually were building and construction the Fuhrer Hauptquartier and the Fuhrer bunkers and the tunnels, whether they be under Berlin or under Obersalzberg, the SS main office was not involved in the construction of any of these sites. So the cover story that Kammler was working on the Fuhrer Hauptquartier bunkers does seem very implausible if we look at what he was actually doing and if you look at who was actually building the bunkers for Hitler. Let's take a look at the diagrams of what Kammler was doing and hold them up against what Hitler's bunkers actually did look like. There are very, very few similarities. Let me show you. The underground in Obersalzberg is quite interesting. It contains quite a lot of different tunnels. Most of them have been covered up in various ways, and it takes quite a lot of engineering to get down into them. However, in the Plattenhof bunker under the hotel, we see today one of the remaining bunker systems that is actually possible to visit due to the museum. And it was constructed the exact same as Hitler's tunnel system beneath it. They're all very reminiscent of those constructions of the Ostwald, however they're generally smaller. The underground shelters for Hitler up in Obersalzberg begun in 1943. They were constructed by specialists and mining engineers, and the entire complex eventually grew into a much larger underground tunnel system connecting, or nearly connecting, the various SS underground tunnels leading from Hotel Türken. Martin Bormann had his bunker and system from under his house, Göring the same, and so on. Here in this episode, I'm not going into details about the systems, their constructions, or layout. What I want to show you is what the general construction of these tunnels looked like. I wanted to show you what Hitler's bunkers looked like and make my case as to why Kammler was not building them.
Down the stairs is the first security area where you come straight down to the three machine guns. That is pointing up here. And of course, there's a bend in the tunnel, and that's up to the Plattenhof. That is no more. When you turn this corner, it's very interesting. This entire construction underneath the Obersalzberg looks very similar to what I have seen in the East Wall. Tunnel construction is roughly the same. Security measures are sort of the same. And the armor plate that used to sit on one of these is now lying on the ground. I had the three firing positions, and I guess they're low so they can actually point up the stairways. There are people coming down that stairs, and one of the armor plates that would have held the machine gun. And this also is a bit different than what you see. It's also quite possibly a little bit thicker, and it's layered. This is actually not solid. This looks like it's layered by 7-8 layers of metal plate, which is somewhat different. I'm not entirely sure that is from here, because here you see them built into the wall and they're still in place. So the plate here is not from here, but it's good that it's here. Right after the guard position, you have the gas airlock that is here. Of course, the railings are new. And underneath this tunnel, you have lots of technical tunnels running underneath this, and some 20 meters below this is another section where Hitler's actual bunker was. And this looks like a very large gas filter, but I could be wrong because it's not sectioned. I can almost make up what it says. And there was fire and some vandalism in here in the years after the war. And there's another one, so I do think this probably is a gas filter. And here you have down to one of the technical levels. But it's interesting that even here, the gas room is made in red brick. And there is rubber between the bricks and the cement, which is very, very interesting. Really heavy rubber pieces. Of course, this is new, but it is an X shape, just the same. The door leading into the airlock. And after the war, a lot of people, including a lot of American soldiers, came and went and put a lot of graffiti in these walls. But the tunnels up here, they're not very low under the ground. And right inside the first gas lock, you have the air raid shelter. And up here, this is the only air raid shelter there is, which is quite large. And you have the two bathrooms, and sanitary and everything else in place. And this is not unlike, again, what I've seen in the East Wall. And there's the bathrooms.
Because it makes little difference which specific bunker we're looking at, Hitler's bunker here looks exactly the same as Göring's, Bormann's. The tunnels, the security, the access, the staircases are all built identical. Here at the construction sites, there were cement filling shafts like we've seen everywhere else in the Kammler construction sites, and there are several layers of inner defensive with firing ports.
So this is the air raid shelter. At least the remaining one that we can see here at Obersalzberg. There's a vast complex of tunnels underneath.
Extremely reputable historians have been inside these tunnels and documented them as it was possible to visit them over the years. The US Army filmed a walkthrough of Hitler's tunnel system here. So we have very little doubt as to what was there or what wasn't there, and it must be said, Hitler did not spend a whole lot of time in any of these tunnels, if even maybe visiting them once. Towards the end of the war, Obersalzberg had been bombed severely by the Allied air forces, and as the war had ended, the SS security troops had left the area to be vandalized and robbed initially by the locals, who took everything they could from the destroyed Berghof and the tunnels they could gain access to. By war's end, the bunker system was not complete, and lots of construction materials were found everywhere. Again, most of it was looted by locals, but still, they were deep tunnels they did not access and were quietly covered up post-war. Some of these you'll still find filled with ventilation, equipment, support wood, quite possibly a few other things. It certainly is one of the tunnel systems that should be rediscovered, reopened, and made accessible for a number of reasons.
So this is where the transformer was. Again, the tunnel that very much resembles the east wall. What I wanted to see was this. I wanted to see how this was constructed. I wanted to see what these tunnels looked like. And they resembled the east wall construction, not the larger construction that you see in the years of the war, and certainly not anything we're seeing that Dr. Kammler has built. Of course, the walking bridge is new for the tourists. The generator and so on. If you look at the rooms, if you look up in the roof, you're seeing technical access tunnels, panels, that just barely scrape the roof of this. And that's not something I've seen anywhere else before. That's very different from how the Germans would usually make technical tunnels. The access holes I've seen before, but not with this little space above, which is very interesting. We have the technology or technical tunnels for the generators. Stands. And the writing on the wall from the builders that was here. And the French that was here that wrote this as the war ended for them.
The power for this section of the bunker was provided by two diesel engines, and even when you go through here and you look at the roof ducts above which cabling would be run, the sheer size and layout doesn't resemble anything we've seen, not in Riese, certainly not in the castle, where you have some of the most complete tunnels, but everything is laid out completely different. These, I were informed by the museum staff, were the fuel compartments. I see no such thing for any of the generators out under the castle.
I mean, these tiny, tiny fuel tanks, is this really all there was in these little rooms? In this little tunnel? Transformer room. Now this tunnel is where it starts to get interesting and very nicely lit it up for us. Because now we're coming down to the guest bunker, and at the end of here there's the tunnel down to Hitler's bunker, which is of course not accessible. Here you have at the kitchen, that's the kitchen's storage rooms. And you see this and you see east wall construction technology. This is the same type of building. The forage rooms. here you have shrapnel on the roof from an explosion that happened after the war. And this is Bormann's filing room. Wonder where did all Bormann's files go? And underneath here, there is, and under the ground here, there's another technical tunnel. And in here, you had the guest house. And on the floor of the guest house, there's a very large safe. And down here, towards where the access to Hitler's bunker is, there is another airlock here on the side that is not finished. Just like everywhere else in Germany, in Austria, wherever they were still working. This was supposed to have been another airlock that is closer to where Hitler would have gone in.
Things that really stands out about the Obersalzberg bunkers, so much of the construction, including here the airlock, is built in red brick with insulation underneath, but still.
See this really heavy rubber between the red brick and the cement outer wall. I have not seen that anywhere, but it makes sense as a water resistant layer because in none of the other tunnels we see red brick. So, of course, they would have to insulate it.
In the tunnels leading up to the Kehlstein house, they insulate those with corrugated metal plate.
Another airlock here on the side that is not finished. There's a bathroom on the right, but this is where it really gets interesting. This is arched masonry. This is not how the tunnels you usually see me go through look like.
And here you see the very large shaft, which is square, not round, that once had a wooden staircase that was destroyed by the SS towards the end of the war, that leads down into Hitler's actual section, where Hitler's bunker and bathroom, that of Eva Braun and her bathroom, were located. There's also square access tunnels and still some of the naked tunnels way down below that does, in some way, reminisce of an unfinished construction project. And indeed, these tunnels were nowhere near done by the time the war ended. Here you also had Hitler's film library inspected by the US Army soldiers after the war. But what really stands out about the tunnels under Obersalzberg when compared to all the other constructions we've seen over the past few years, is this does strikingly look like a small air raid bunker. It's not a place you would in any which way be capable of putting any kind of construction or machinery into. It is where you go for shelter with the rudimentaries of machinery, generators, fuel, food, kitchens, to house the most important people during an air raid. You would not be fighting from here, you would not be producing here, you wouldn't be living here for a very long time. And that is exactly what it looks like. And that does not square up with anything I've seen at any of the other sites that were constructed by General Kammler and his team, and that is important. And it's quite possible, if the local government would stop sealing up everything and destroying the various entrances, opening up to historians would inevitably lead to discoveries of tunnel systems that might not have been found and researched. Although, that's not why we're here in this particular visit, what I wanted to show you is the general size and layout of these tunnel systems, of the bunkers, the guest bunker, the air raid shelters, the security measures. They're all the same here. And in recent episodes, as you have all journeyed with me, we have gone through the very large construction sites of General Kammler. We have witnessed the size of the sites that he built deep underground, miles and miles of underground tunnels large enough for trains, for B-2 rockets to be built into. Even the A-9, 10, the America rocket was supposed to be built in some of these up in Ebensee. General Kammler did not construct small, little air raid shelters, even for Hitler. And you can quite clearly see the difference in design and layout here. Here the only large, round shaft built for stairs that reminisce something we've seen on Project Reise is built in red brick leading up to Bormann's house. This was the huge industrial-sized elevator shaft that we saw at Castle Fürstenstein. It is the closest thing that we see here in Obersalzberg to what is now the closed Goering bunkers tunnel. The tunnels under Obersalzberg did not appear to be laid out according to one detailed master plan to be followed. It is several strands of smaller tunnel systems that were supposed to eventually connect, and some may indeed have. But they did not have that great scale that we see in the wartime production for factories. And when one is looking at the tunnel systems, this is the one of Hitler's alone, there does seem to be a randomness and somewhat of a lack of uniformity in design. Also, of course, they had to match the evolution of buildings above ground. And they have to match the systems coming from the existing buildings, such as here the Hotel Türken. But none of them really matches the design or size and scale of General Kammler's construction works. One of the things about this visit that frustrates me the most is the original entrance under the renovated Hotel Platterhof had been destroyed in order to facilitate the rebuild of the new Obersalzberg Documentation Museum, which to me is tantamount to destroying history in order to put up a modern museum with pictures, as opposed to restoring, opening and securing the tunnels so people actually see history. But it may just be a personal opinion. Not far from what used to be Hitler's house, it's one of the more interesting structures, I'll say. Kochsbunker. I'm sort of surprised to see that these are open. But we're looking at coal storage. Some 600 meters from here, Hitler's residence would be. So have coal and fuel storage readily available nearby. So what this looks like is there would be coal stored or delivered up on the roadside, come down here through slides, and then be available for pickup. It literally is just a coal storage. There's not much to it here. The Fuhrer bunker in Berlin under the Reich Chancellery was constructed in two phases, 1936 and 1944, and it was still not complete by the end of the war. The bunker under the Reichskanzlei was initially constructed as a temporary air raid shelter for Hitler. He actually spent very little time in the capital during the war, and due to the increased bombing of Berlin, it led to an expansion of the complex. AG built the first air raid cellar, as it was referred to, with a ceiling thickness of 1.6 meters and a wall thickness of 1.2 for the cost of 250,000 Reichsmarks, which can be said to be very, very little, considering the cost of Hitler's tea house was 30 million Reichsmarks. Now, the initial planning for the enlargement began in 1942, and since the air raid shelter under the Reichschancellery only had a ceiling thickness of 1.6 meters, the new bunker was to be built under the garden, where there was more room to dig down and thus create a thicker ceiling of between 3.5 and 4 meters. But the interior size were to be the same as the already existing bunker. Architect Karl Pleppenburg was to be in charge of the construction. And workers from the Hochschief AG began its foundation trench, which is about 10 meters deep, in the Reichschancellery's garden in front of the reception hall in early 1944. The new bunker construction was registered as construction project B207. and it was supposed to be able to withstand the strongest known Allied bombs with its thick reinforced concrete ceiling. The cost of the bunker was 1.35 million Reichsmarks, not a lot by any means. The interior dimensions for both the old Vorbunker and the Fuhrer's bunker was 15 by 20 with a 3-meter high ceiling. Also, an additional meter of thick layer reinforced cement cover was to be added to reinforce to the ceiling. So in the end, what that left you with were two bunkers, two systems, one built in 1936, which was the Vorbunker, that was located underneath the large reception hall in the old Reichschancellery, and then the new Fuhrerbunker that was located 2.5 meters lower than the Vorbunker that was completed in 1944. They were connected by a stairway set at right angles that could be closed off from each other by a bulkhead and steel doors. After descending into the stairs into the lower section and passing through three steel doors, there was a long corridor with a series of rooms on each side. On the right sides were the generator, ventilation rooms, telephone, switchboard. Here were also offices for adjutants, including their bedrooms, and that for Dr. Morell also had a bedroom here. On the left side was Eva Braun's bedroom, through another door that left into Hitler's study, and on the wall of which hung a large portrait of Frederick the Great. Another door would lead into Hitler's very small, modestly furnished bedroom. Next to that was the conference room, also known as the briefing situation room, of which had another door that led into a waiting room. So the new Fuhrerbunker was actually identical to the old one, except it was built lower and far better reinforced. The original Vorbunker now served as an entrance and offices for key staff and important personnel. There was an entrance leading down into the bunkers from the Reichschancellery, and also an emergency exit up to the garden. The Fuhrerbunker development was built by the Hochschief Company as part of an extensive program of subterranean construction in Berlin, which began in 1940. And the Berlin Underground is a very interesting chapter that deserves a whole show of its own, but that's not why we're here today. The bunker complex was self-sustained. However, the Fuhrerbunker was located below the water table, so conditions were quite unpleasant. They were damp, and pumps had to be continuously running to remove the groundwater. A diesel generator provided electricity, and well water was pumped in as the main water supply. Communication systems also included telex, telephone switchboard, and an army radio set up with an outdoor antenna. But I'll be honest, there's nothing really special or elaborate about this bunker system. It was an air raid shelter. Large, elaborate, well reinforced, underground, near to key buildings. It was constructed fairly quickly, and we know the construction companies who did it. The SS and General Kammler had no involvement in this, and there's no big mystery here. It just served the purpose for which it was constructed. But now, when you glance at the constructions we know were carried out by General Kammler during the war, they had very little in common in every way with what we've seen both in Obersalzberg and in Berlin. These bunkers were far smaller than anything Kammler built. He specialized in very large tunnels, capable of holding construction machinery, building tanks, planes, and rockets. He had a carefully designed plan when he showed up, with tight schedules, labor supplies, logistics, and teams working 24 hours a day. Tens of thousands of laborers and skilled teams, and moreover, these were all under the auspices of the SS. Whereas the bunkers built for Hitler was not constructed by the SS. They were far smaller in scale and scope, and built by civilian companies, contractors, or the Todt organization. And one could say they were a far lower priority, as they were not complete by war's end, except for that of the Wolfslair. Now, when George Rybienski said Kammler did not have time to waste building bunkers for Hitler, he was correct. Kammler was trying to win the war by generating war production. And by the use of the cement in the Third Reich, it seems to bear out that war production was the priority over that of Hitler's bunkers. Although at the Wolfslair we did see a very large expenditure in cement, as all of it had to be built above ground with no tunnels or rocks to aid in protection. They had to be built bigger and stronger with more cement as they were all above ground and vulnerable. They were also scattered in different security zones, and this gave a completely different layout than the one in Berlin and the Alps. And also, this was the place where Hitler spent some 800 days of the war, took most of his meetings, made most of the decisions, and there had to be bunkers for all the key personnel that had to be near him for running the war. But again, Kammler was not involved in the construction, nor was the SS. The Wolfslair was a constant construction site. It consumed a large part of the cement available for the Reich. However, not even half as much of Project Reise, and that makes it interesting for comparisons. The Wolfslair was initially built over a 6.5 square kilometer area. In the middle of East Prussia, surrounded by lakes, in a place that mosquitoes goes for holidays. It consisted of three security zones, and guarded, of course, by the SS, the SD, Hitler's personal bodyguard, and the Army Armored Begleitskommando. The complex consisted eventually over 80 buildings, with the largest bunkers constructed for Hitler, Bormann, and Göring. There were up to 2,000 people working at Wolfschanze at its peak. And interestingly enough, according to Albert Speer, the construction only cost 36 million Reichsmarks. That's only six more than for the Kittelstein house. This may be some indication that things got cheaper to build as the war started and labor became available. The largest bunker here was Hitler's personal bunker, with a 5 meter thick wall of reinforced concrete covered with another roof of an additional 8 meters thick reinforced concrete. There was also a flak gun on the roof. This bunker served Hitler as a home and work area, although he did have a house here as well, and mostly took his meetings in one of the large reinforced office buildings nearby. The bunker also had two wings on the sides that housed a kitchen and ventilation and heating apparatus. Ventilation is very important here. Hitler's bunker was originally built with walls 2 to 3 meters thick, but that was eventually upgraded and upgraded again. These large bunkers were only to be used for air raid shelters, except the one of Hitler's, in which was the only one that had living quarters. It is an interesting note that most of these bunkers are extremely large on the outside, but the working area inside is actually quite small. In 1944, as German forces left the Wolfslair, orders were given for all the buildings and bunkers to be demolished or blown up, yet most of them still stand in somewhat intact order. Yet Hitler's bunker is the most damaged, and it's still impossible to get into the center. There were also other large bunkers here for communication, and an extremely large guest bunker, and those for the Army High Commands as well.
Ceiling, we all know. And then here, the roof have come down. It would have been Hitler's study in here. So this was the original structure. And you see on top here, sitting there, is piece of an additional added piece of reinforcement. This is fascinating. Again, there. But this is, again, you're looking at red brick on the outer layer. Now we have the roof of the adjoining building. What actually looks like a small window, although I don't understand why they would be looking at another. There wouldn't be any firing slits or any other like we're used to. You see, I actually have piece of wood here for the door. So wooden dowels were in place right here. This is the side of Hitler's bunker. So when it was blown quite well. And several stories, one story there, two, and a third.
would have been part of the roof. It's hard to say. Again, this would have been an add-on in some way. And here, this would have been the divide between the inner and outer wall. Or it could have been a hallway. Again, it's hard to say. I'm thinking hallway because there's wood pegs here and here. So I'm thinking walkway. And up here, you're looking straight through the side of it. Again, it was blown quite well, and it was surrounded by what looked like red tile. And underneath me is a walkway into it. This could have been part of the roof of Hitler's bunker thrown here. I am sort of leaning towards that theory. And since I'm not standing on ground down here, was either original spacing with the main building here, and certainly well destroyed. And here, this must have been a wall, and this certainly must have been an outer wall, because here you have stairs leading to the roof on the outside. This is the exterior wall. That broke apart from here. So this is one exterior wall with an underground passage to a small bunker next to it. And this was Bormann's. So that explains it. Far larger than the one we saw at Himmler. This was a heavy general purpose air raid shelter. 36 by 23 meters. And because this was due to the proximity of the home of Bormann, Hitler's secretary, this was referred to as Bormann's bunker. It was built from scratch, obviously, but there was never a structure in place before it. It was commissioned in mid-1944, and it had only one entrance through the corridor, protected with armored and gas-tight doors, just like everything else. It served as a heavy air raid bunker and used exclusively in case of threats, and it's equipped with benches, so no one lived here.
There should have been a door here. It's completely compressed in the middle. And the inner casing.
This was a shelter for contingencies. Every building here, the Wolfslair, of these major shelters, has, just like Himmler's structure, been the inner and outer shell have been separated by 50 centimeters of basalt. So in case it was hit by an aerial bomb, the outer shell would explode and be destroyed, but the inner would remain intact.
You see the reinforcement inside and the rebar. This was the outer wall that fell. You see the metal beams sticking up there, running through the top of the structure. This is very, very, very huge. Typically, this is something you would build underground, certainly. But if you have to build it above ground to protect against air raids, this is what you would see. And this is the wall of the inner shell that fell away from the outer shell. And you see the separation. It actually looks like there are three layers of separation. Again, it has been exploded quite well. Here's the separation. This is interesting because it looks like here's an inner wall and an outer wall, and then a third layer. This being one part, a second middle wall, and a third, that in there being the inside of the bunker.
It's hard not to be a little bit impressed with what they built out here.
When it was demolished, the walls blew apart and the roof came down in that position here. But it must have taken a lot. This looks like a piece of the roof that landed on its back. And there are more smaller pieces sitting in the woods surrounding.
And just for the sake of playing a game of where was he, at the initial construction of the Wolfslair, as it was planned in 1940, and construction began in 1941, General Kammler was not involved, nor at the time was he even a general. He was appointed as construction director for the Reich Aviation Ministry in 1940. In 1941, he joined the Waffen-SS. And soon Himmler appointed him head of Office 2, construction, in the SS main office, and also tasked him with the physical construction of the labor camp system, as well as other things. Now Kammler's responsibilities soon grew. In 1943, Himmler put him in charge of overseeing the development of the underground production facilities for the A4 rocket. He was also commissioned to direct the underground construction works undertaken by the SS for the production of fighter aircraft, and as a special representative for achieving the operational capability launching of the say A4 missiles as well. Very little of these offices gave him any reason to be involved with building bunkers or headquarters for Hitler or the top brass. He was way too busy with other things. His offices were about winning the war and special programs, not building security centers. And not only that, he was spending a far larger amount of money on his projects than on Hitler's bunkers, or even the tea house. And for comparison to the tea house, the V-1 and 2 rocket systems and programs cost over 604 million Reichsmarks. That is twice as much as the Manhattan program. And for capability comparisons, one interesting pre-war construction project stands out as the Kehlstein House. It was commissioned by Martin Bormann to be built for Hitler's birthday. It was used skilled workmen throughout. They built a little tea house and a restaurant on top of a naked alpine peak outcropping. They built it in less than a year, with six tunnels and a road leading up to it, all the way up to 1834 meters of a ridge. The architect was only given 4 weeks to design the actual building. And interestingly enough, quite a few people from the various architectural firms volunteered to work on the project for Hitler, as well as many of the local farmers would come to help out when problems came up. 1,300 workers were employed to build the Eagle's Nest. Water pumps, compressors, generators served the worksite as well. And the rocks from the excavation of the road and the tunnel were used in the actual construction also. This would blend in and make it look natural. The tunnel leading into the elevator, that would shoot up into the house, was about 100 meters long, and it was dug out in only 2 weeks.
I will say this is the first time on this trip where I got to a mountaintop without having to climb the whole way.
At the end of the tunnel, interestingly enough, before turning into the elevator section, a stone swastika had been built into the stone wall. However, Hitler asked for it to be covered up by a large bronze door. I do not know why. The construction of this entire marvel, this wonderful little tea house, cost 30 million Reichsmarks. And given the price of the bus tours up there today, they're still trying to recover that cost. It took about a year to build, broken up by winter. 10 people died during the construction, 9 from accidents, and 1 who was stabbed to death after a bet had gone wrong. And there's some conflicting information as to just how often Hitler would visit it up here. Some say he was not entirely thrilled with the high altitudes, and yet there's some 40 visits logged, according to the now new owners of the restaurant up here, and I can highly recommend the schnitzel. It's a great place to visit. It's beautiful, quiet, peaceful, fresh air. One could see why Hitler would want to go up here and get away from the world, read his newspaper, and have a piece of cake.
I completely understand why you want your peace and quiet time up here. I'm so glad this was not destroyed in the war or after.
Now, I did say I would go to Hitler's tea house, have cake and a coffee, but I forgot my cigars and I feel terrible about it. But it is a very nice place that you absolutely should visit if you ever get to go here. And the schnitzel is phenomenal, but this is not a food show. I wanted you to see this place because the Kahlstein House was in many ways a microcosm of the wartime construction projects. It was not just a matter of building a tea house. This entailed everything, and a lot of new lessons was learned that would be very useful during the wartime projects to come. Miles of mountain roads had to be built, tunnels both horizontally and vertically. Huge amounts of construction materials had to be brought up and onto a mountain peak where it had to be assembled. The tunnels had to be insulated by corrugated steel plates to keep them dry, and 1,000 workers had to be housed and fed. And many of the techniques put in place were new and untested, seen here for the first time. So if there was to be any of Hitler's places we could compare to those later special constructions carried out by Kammler during the war, the large tea house would probably be the one. But when the war started, immigration out of Germany now ended. And for those Jews who had remained, they would soon be joined in labor camps by millions of prisoners of war, and it was inevitable that this would result in them becoming part of the labor pool for the Reich. The Kahlstein House was built and paid for by party funds. The workers were paid, but this new workforce, forced laborers, only had to be guarded and fed somewhat. And it would stand to logistical reason that the speed of SS constructions could from that point on be done faster and bigger after the war had begun, and these restrictions, such as having to pay people, vanished. And if we are to discover what research was really conducted by the German scientists during the war, we need to know several things. Where the research was done, or could have been done, and where production could have been prepared for. And in order to determine how big and advanced the scale of work was, we can follow the labor and the resources spent. Now I'm trying to do this as I follow in the footsteps of General Kammler in order to find those missing pieces and see where they lead. Interestingly enough, the maps recently sent to me by the CIA contains 20 of Kammler's constructions as they were mapped by the CIC after the war. Yet, the S3, Riese, and the Becketal tunnels were all not on there. And those we know of, and we know exactly how important they were to the war effort. So by omitting these at the time, it seems the CIA also indicates that this is not information readily available. And now the quest is for what other omissions from the official records we can find by following the trail of resources and labor. But the explanation of there's nothing there, but you can't look, it's just not good enough. anymore. I hope you enjoy history and military history as much as I love bringing it to you. And if you want to see more of the photos and documents I've used for these episodes, documentation and so on, you can go to lostbattlefields.com. And if you feel like helping me out traveling around the world to some of these far-flung locations like Van Allen Brown's first test stand behind me, or Deepness nuclear reactor down there, or the Maginot Line over there, you can donate on PayPal, protection@serviceint.com. It'll be right here, and it is also on lostbattlefields.com. You absolutely don't have to, but I appreciate any help, and I love all you guys for all the support you've shown me, because history is important. We all know that, and I'm going to bring it to you.